That roof right there is coming off and a new one's going in. So I just want to say thank you for you guys.
Yes.
Thank you for everything. It's an amazing feat. And we couldn't have done it without you guys. Now everyone here, they know like the history of the house. Everyone does?
No, I don't.
You don't? Well, the house itself has a lot more history from when the Millers and the Dandies lived here. The main story that people know about the house is in 74, the family was so distraught over the activity and the paranormal interactions in the house that they reached out to St. Bonaventure for help. And Father Alphonsus Trebold came to the house and he felt the dark presence, and he also brought a psychic by the name of Alex Tanis to help him in the de-psyching and what ended up being an exorcism of the house. Well, the ritual that was performed didn't really clear the house. Even to this day, there's still reports of activity, people seeing stuff, hearing stuff. Even these guys will attest last night, they had their own interesting experiences. So even though that took place back in 74, here we are in 2013, and we still are able to interact and still able to see the different footprints that the spirits have left on the home. But tonight, we actually have Chris DiCesare, Jeff Unger, and Alan. For those of you guys who don't know, C2D1 Haunting, Geneseo State, he is the haunted survivor. But before we get into Chris's story, we want to bring Alan up so that way he can give us a little backstory on what we're going to be hearing about tonight.
Thank you very much, Mark. My name is Alan Lewis. I have known both these gentlemen here for a good part of my life, so their story has been a big effect on my life, and thus I'm very pleased to be able to introduce them to you tonight. Chris's story does go back to haunting at Geneseo in 1985. He will be talking about that whole story tonight. His story was at one point in time featured on the Sci-Fi Channel. That was during a TV program called School Spirits, focusing a lot on hauntings that happen in school situations. And the episode that that both Chris and John Jeff Unger there were featured in was called Dorm Room Nightmare. And I believe that is available through the internet and Hulu and places like that, so if you're interested. And both those gentlemen did appear. There was some reenactment that happened during the course of that as well. But also, there was a film made independently that a lot of us were involved in that recreated the events. It was called Please Talk With Me. Now that was, in addition to being made into a movie, there's also a book that accompanied with it. After the lecture tonight, if you are interested, Mr. Unger does have some DVD copies of the movie that's going for $20. There is a Blu-ray edition going for $25. And we have copies of the book called Please Talk With Me also. That was written by Reverend Tim Shaw with a foreword by John Zappas, the Haunted Collector. And that will be available as well for $20 if you're interested. We don't have the capacity to make take credit cards though, so we would ask if you are interested in that, we can accept cash for that. As well, and the story continues in some ways. There's going to be a follow-up movie. It's in post-production right now. It's called Surviving Evidence. That will be premiering at the Proctor's Theater in Albany, New York. That's going to be on October 5th. That's going to be brought to the screen by Glory House Hunts. How, How's that again?
Glory Haunt Hounds?
Glory Haunt Hounds, a little bit of a tongue twister there. If you are interested, if you go to our the Facebook page for the movie, which is Please Talk With Me, you'll also find information there about surviving evidence. Also from that Facebook page, Chris has been on many different radio shows and continues to be on different radio shows. Some of those previous radio appearances can be accessed from the site. And as well, any festivals he attends will be on there as well. He is keeping a full schedule. There's a lot of new stuff going on. So again, this the story goes back to 1985. Chris will be telling you that story. Afterwards, there will be a chance for you to ask questions and answers. But meanwhile, I'd just like to say that all three of us, through the graciousness of our hosts, were able to stay here ourselves last night. And having experienced that, we just think this is a wonderful place. We're so appreciative of the work that's being done here. And so a big thank you for the opportunity. And we're just so appreciative of preserving this place. So great. So that said, my friend, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chris DiCesare.
I am standing up. My name is Chris DiCesare, and almost 30 years ago, I was the person at Geneseo they called the Ghost Boy. I never liked that. I liked having a name that my parents gave me, but over time, you'll see, in high school, in college, at work, you get names put upon you. You get masks on you. You become a jock or a nerd or a brain or, a role player, a geek. So, and sometimes we act in a way that corroborates with that. I want to be perceived this way. I want to dress a certain way. I want to talk a certain way. I want to be with certain kinds of people because I'm comfortable, or I want to be perceived in that fashion. My experience is that you can do that if you'd like. If it brings you comfort, if it brings you financial gain, if it brings you some peace of mind. But when push comes to shove, when there's a moment that you can't control, the real you's gonna come out. For better or for worse, the real you comes out. And you can see, if you're in that spot, by choice or otherwise, who you are. And sometimes what you find out about yourself is good, sometimes it's bad, but it's always insightful. And I can tell you that this haunting was unexpected. It was sudden. It came out of nowhere. And it affected over a dozen people. And the people I thought would be strong, that would stay, that would hold on and explore, they hightailed it out. The people I thought, well, they're not gonna, they can't possibly handle this, they're not built for this, it's not within their, their skill set, they hung tight. It's amazing how what's on the inside, you really can't see. And I'm fortunate enough to be here today to tell you what happened to me because of people that hung by through those times for me. And my life has changed dramatically since that television show. And I want to just give you a 1 or 2 minute update on what's happening with me before I jump into the story, which is very, very fascinating, I think, looking back. If I went to a para conference, 2-3 years ago, I would have been in the aisle that would say, sir, you're in the way, please excuse me. Oh, okay, no problem. I'm the same person who was shooed away 2 years ago, but now because I was on the television, I was in a movie and there's a book about me. Oh my gosh, I just love your story. Can you just hold my hand for a second? What, did you see my aura? No duck face, right? But I'm the same exact person. But the perception of who I am has flipped. And it's weird when you spend your whole life being one thing, and your friends know who you are, and your family, and your coworkers, but the rest of the world, which is a lot more than your friends and your coworkers, perceive you totally differently. It's the strangest thing. And so one of the things that I've learned from this experience is not to forget your friends and your family, because they were there with you from the start. And it's nice to have people appreciate what you've gone through. It's nice to do something and work on something that gets some notoriety. It feels nice. But the most important thing I can tell you is hold on to the people that you love. Hold on to them. We don't know how much time we have. And you'll see when I go through the haunting how I learned that lesson. We might have one more day, we might have 50 years. But nothing's promised us. And rather than living our lives holding on to anger or pain or hatred, if I can just offer one thing, try to breathe. Try to live your lives in a way that you enjoy them. You know, we won't truly know what's over there until we get there. You know, we can listen. We can create EVPs, we can get his photographs, we can go through different locations. We get a snapshot. But you know, when I was 10 years old, my parents made me tap dance. Oh boy. I had a little soldier suit on and I was tap dancing this and... I love my mom. So if that one picture lasts of me for many years, people say, oh, who's a tap dancer? No, I wasn't. I was a reluctant tap dancer for one day. But that's the evidence we had. People say, you know what, he's a tap dancer. Look at the tap dancers for all these years and see, we'll find, must be this guy here. All right, we don't truly know all the facts until when we get there. That's part of the mystique of it. That's part of the anguishing part, because we want to know more and more. And as Mark had said, you know, we spent the night last night. What a fascinating place. I've only been to 3 locations in my life. One, because I had to be there, and 2 by choice, that were like this beautiful landmark. Where you go into there and you say, wow, something amazing is happening here. And I'm telling you this not because they let us stay here last night. I'm telling you the truth. It's a nice day. You know? So let me backtrack now, going way back to a little time. I'm getting younger and thinner and younger and thinner and younger and thinner. Much better. And it's 1985. On January 30th, I'm going to stand up a little bit just so I can talk, because what I experienced was very traumatic. And if I sit down, I'll be fidgeting and move my hands, and I need to stretch the energy, because in many ways it's like a divorce or losing a child for me, because it was the darkest time of my life. And so as I go through and recreate those moments to share with you in my mind what I experienced, I can't just do what they say on TV. Put your finger into your thumb like this, and you tongue top of your mouth, and they teach you how to do things. I just can't do that because it's not an act. You know, it's just something I experienced. January 30th, 1985. A suite mate of mine at Geneseo University wants to go to a presentation. And the presentation is being given by 2 people, Ed and Lorraine Warren, who I guess were demonologists. I didn't know at the time, but I guess they were famous, and they talked about Amityville Horror and Haunting Connecticut. I had no clue. To me, Warren was a county over by Lake George. That's all I knew. But it was free. My friend wanted to go, and he's by himself, so I said, okay, I will go. And I sat there in that auditorium, and my expectation was, this is gonna be fun, like a puppet show or a cartoon. It doesn't cost me anything, I'll sit there for an hour, I'll be amused by people's thoughts about, you know, the ghost of the orangutan of, you know, Smithtown. I didn't know, I just thought it'd be a funny thing. And in fact, as they began to talk, Ed and Lorraine, and it was like kind of like Elvis and Colonel Parker. That's how I saw it when I was younger. Lorraine was very regal. She was like the Elvis to me. She could perform and she could talk and she moved her hands in a way. And I thought, that's pretty darn cool. It was fun to watch her talk. Whether or not I believe what she was saying or not, it was fun to watch her. And Ed was kind of like, he'd watch over and make sure things were cool. He'd make sure she was okay. He'd give her water. He'd attend to all the EVPs and whatnot. So it was cool to watch. I liked it. I was impressed by their ability to put on a show. That was pretty good for me. But I noticed people around me were really fascinated, they're really focused. They were listening to every word they said. They're almost drawn into this new world I'd never experienced before. For me, there were 2 ghost jokes as a kid. There was Casper, he was friendly, he wasn't real. And according to my faith, there was the Holy Ghost, and that was Jesus. And so I didn't really have intimate relationships with one of these people. They're one of these things, you know? So I thought, well, ghosts out here. And I like science fiction, so that's cool. The time machine was kind of cool, you know, and I like all that. So I began to ask questions on a notebook. Okay, well, if there are ghosts, why can't I see them? You know, if there are ghosts, how come we can't prove that? We can see germs now and bacteria. We can see ultraviolet rays. Why can't we prove that? Okay, well, if this is really the case, then how come you're here talking about something helping people? How come, out of all these sarcastic teenage questions that you would ask because you want to prove somebody wrong? My friend sat there, and he was very deferential. He listened, he had questions about the lady in white, he wrote them down. He was really taking a lot of notes to maybe interact with them later on, ask some questions. At the end of the presentation, there was a chance for us to go down and meet Ed and Lorraine and say hello. And again, I didn't put any stock into what they were saying at that time. I just thought, well, that's pretty cool. And if you go to some event, whether it's a juggler or it's a hypnotist, whoever this is, a motivational speaker, they like to meet them, make a personal connection. Politicians do that. Right, running for office, you went to them for 4 years. Next month's election, hey, how you doing? My name is, I think I know you. They want to make the personal connection. Where's your baby? All right, but again, I thought that's pretty interesting how that you can actually go and meet these people and build a personal bond. And that'd be good for selling books, that'd be good for all these things, you know, like, that's pretty, wow. Again, I had no expectation anything was real behind that, what I need to be a facade. As I approached on this line, I think the Department of Motor Vehicles waiting to get your license renewed, you know, you're waiting like this. And again, I think every person in that auditorium wanted to shake their hand and say hello. I got to the first in line, and I went to put my hand out like this. And Lorraine looked at me and said, oh no, I don't want to know my future. And I was like, what? Ed stood up, he got in front of Lorraine, and blocked me. And I thought, what is going on? I don't understand. Why is, I'm not a tall guy, maybe the guy behind me? No, it was my friend. What? So I couldn't shake her hand. So I got escorted away. I'm like, what? I felt very bad about that. My friend got to meet him real quick. Afterwards, Ed and Lorraine were going to go on this tour of a campus at C2D1 Geneseo to look for activity. And my friend said, we should go on that. We should go. I said, I'm not going to go. They were mean to me. They said something about reading futures. I shook my hand. I don't like any of this. Let's just go. So he agreed to go back to the dorm with me and let me sulk for not being, you know, treated properly. We lived in a dorm called Erie Hall. Not like two E's, one like Lake Erie, which of course should have been, looking back, two E's because it was Erie. We get back and my friend says to me, did you do anything wrong? What do you mean? Were you making faces? Were you making hand gestures? Were you making like moose ears? I'm like, I sat next to you the whole time. I did nothing. I don't know what's happening. So I said, well, maybe there's something about you don't know. Maybe it's just your family. Maybe you have, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, this man.
So, we, like fireflies. We couldn't understand what happened. We put it to rest. That episode was over, kind of like a bad meal. On February 9th, 10 days later, I was sitting in my dorm room. And I was working on a college paper. And if you went to college, you know that's a chore. We didn't have Google back then, or the internet back then, or cut and paste. We didn't have Wikipedia, so you actually had to look up a book on this big, big wooden thing called the Dewey Decimal Block. And you had to find these cards. If you're old, remember James Earl Jones? Or you're walking. You really have to like go through the cards and you say, aha, 396. Then you have to find where that was. So that was okay. It's like kind of exploring through some area, you know. And you find the shelf and you have to hope the book was there. If the book was there, but if you're taking the same course as 50 other people, it might not be there, then you're out of luck. You waited too long. Luckily for me, I was able to get the books. But then I had to actually read the books. You couldn't just go online and say, let's cut and pick this part. You had to read them. Then you had to understand the key concepts behind what the author was saying or writing and sharing. Then you had to say, of those key points, what relates to my thesis? And then you had to put those things into your words and your thoughts. Then you had to actually spell the words correctly. Then you had to actually type. And we couldn't use this thing called whiteout. You couldn't actually use that. So if you type for 15 minutes, the last line you did a Q instead of a G, says all over again. So I decided, rather than agonize myself and procrastinate, I would start my paper early. My course was called Ethno-Cultural Nonverbal Communications. That was the course name. And it was on somatotypes and culture. I don't know. So I decided I would start my cover page at least. So I'm typing. I know my name, that's pretty easy, and the name of the paper. As I'm typing, I hear, it's like a rush of wind by my ear. I'm like, yeah. I mean, people sometimes will call you. They'll come in the room once in a while. It happens. People call your name, nothing unusual. And I say that because people say, did you jump? I'm like, No, people will always talk to their name. Maybe somebody has sore throat. Maybe they're hiding and saying, I have his notebook. I'll tell him. Maybe it's a joke. So I just went. I heard it a second time. So I said, what? And I was alarmed because nobody was there in college dorm room. I was on the second floor of this. It's basically three buildings, second floor, and a quad. It's called the C2D1 Haunting because it's the C building, the second floor, the D quad, and I was in the very first room. So I stood up, and I walked over to the door. And I said, hello? Nobody. I'm up, so I walked to the window, looked down outside, open the window, nobody. The weird thing to me was, not that no one was there, just it sounded so close to my head. It sounded like the person was in the room. I thought, well, you know, maybe it's a practical joke. Maybe somebody on my cross-country team or my track team or history club wanted to pull a joke on me. And you know how those things work. You do a joke because it's a reaction. And it's fun to watch the reaction of the person. Later on you say, yeah, we got you. I don't know why we do that as human beings. I don't know what part of our character that is, but people do that. So I figured, you know what? If I put headphones on, if I put on some music, I can't hear what these people are doing, these friends or, you know, people in the dorm, and they can't affect me. So I went to my roommate, with my roommate's stereo, I got headphones, I put on Sammy Hagar, Voice of America, and I played, I can't drive 55! Which you should, by the way, in most places. It's gonna get kids here. All right, so, it gets to the second stanza, and I like that song. Even though the measurement was appropriate, I like the song, it sounded good. In the second, and I hear, over the music, in the headset, I hear, and I stood up, I threw the headset down. I thought, oh my God, these people are good. I didn't think, ooh, it's a ghost. I didn't think like, is that you, great grandma? I thought, man, they're pros. These people, whoever they are, or it's a fraternity prank, whoever it is, they're good. But I couldn't figure out how they would know I would use the headset. How'd they get access to my room? How would they know my name? How'd they know I'd be? It didn't make any sense. I couldn't understand it. You know what? I'm just gonna go outside in the hallway and just chill, wait there. I waited an hour, I waited 2 hours, and nobody came up to me. No one said, you know, we got you. All right, so I went off, went to the electric dining hall, I had my meal, and I came back, got changed, did my track practice, and I know you can't tell now, but I used to be a very fast runner. I loved to run. It was something that I was given the ability to, either through my parents or some, however it happened, I don't know, but I could run really fast. And I could run a 420 mile and barely break a sweat. Now I get the mailbox, and I'm like, ooh, I can move closer to the house. But it's just an amazing, I didn't appreciate it back then because it just was. I look back, I should run some more, but you know, don't think that way. So I came back from my track practice, and normally when you run distances, you know, you're gonna sweat a bit, you're gonna go very far, but, and you take a shower at the gym. But the pipes had frozen. It was freezing cold on February 9th, 10th, and the pipes had ruptured, so we had to go back to my room. I went back to my room, C2G1, I opened the door, and this is so strange. For the first time, I'd been there September, October, November, December, January, now February, the door goes, I'm like, what is that? Are you kidding me? And I'm looking like, this has to be a joke. You know, he's gone now. Get a door. I'm like, why are they bothering me? So I get my towel and I walk over to the bathroom. And the way the quad was, there was my room, C2D1, C2D2 and 3, a common area with a pool table and things, and a bathroom. The bathroom is right across from my door. You see right there. There's a big wood sliding door and rollers. There was a toilet, two sinks with mirrors, and one shower stall. So I walk in to take my shower, put my towel down, and I go to reach for the nozzle to put the handle to put the shower on, and I couldn't do it. I'm like, what is wrong? I'm shaking. I'm like, what is wrong with me? I had the feeling it was dangerous, that someone was going to watch me, that something I shouldn't do. I'm like, oh, come on. That's ridiculous. I was a nationally ranked runner. I ran in colleges, I ran in Montreal in the marathon. I've taken showers like 1,000 times with myself, 10 people, 50 people, 100 people. For the first time in my life, I was scared to take the shower because I thought to myself, if the water goes over my ears, my eyes, then I can't hear, then I can't see. And if I can't hear and if I can't see, I'm vulnerable. I laughed to myself, I'm like, why am I thinking this? I had showered in this room every day. What is wrong with me? But I could not, for some reason, shake the fear. I said, well, if I can't shake the fear, I've got to problem solve. And my parents raised me to problem solve. I was very fortunate to have two parents. They stayed together. They loved me. My dad said two things to me. He said, I'll give you what you need. What you want is yours. You can take care of that. And I give you a name that's a good name. I've honored the name. Do the same. Don't soil the name. That's all I ask of you. You know, keep your nose clean, basically. Just be an upstanding citizen, and I'll always be proud of you. And when I was in the course of running, I was running at Marist College of Poughkeepsie. I was supposed to win that race. I was being scouted by colleges. I was in third place. I got a side stitch, a cramp. It was so severe, I slowed down. I got, I think, 31st, 32nd place, and I was miserable. And I promised myself, never again. So the next day and every day after, I brought with me bananas, apples, oranges to induce cramps on purpose to run through them next time. They wouldn't stop me. So I was raised to problem solve. I was raised to the next level, you know, and so I problem solved. If I can't put that shower on by myself because I'm scared, I will get someone to guard me. I will get someone to stand there. I don't want to tell them, but I get someone to guard me so I know I'm safe so I take my shower. But how do you do that? Especially back in the 80s. You know, what am I supposed to say? Hey, Bob, I'm taking a shower. Come in. No, hold on. Hey, Ricky, you want to commit? No, I didn't know how to actually express that without them going, what? You know? Luckily for me, one of the few things that happened good for me during this whole 75-day period was that my roommate, and I'm going to call him Peter. I might mess up, but I try not to. And I'll tell you why later on. I use a different name for him. But I'm going to call him Peter. He came down the hallway, and I could hear them because he whistled a certain tune. I heard him come into the quad, open the bedroom door, go in, put his books down, his keys. I figured I'd give him a few minutes, and I'd say, hey, Peter, I want to talk to you for a second. I'll just call him in. We'll just chit-chat. Not a big deal. I didn't get a chance to. He was in that room for maybe 30 seconds, and he began to scream. Oh, shit! I'm like, wow, I thought the room was clean. I thought I cleaned that room, you know? So he comes running out of the hallway. He slams open the bathroom door and comes in like this. He just ran a wind sprint across the football field. He's like, now, of course, he doesn't know I'm there. I'm in the shower stall. Behind the curtain, the water's off. So I go, Peter? He goes, oh, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm taking my shower. Are you okay? He goes, yeah, I'm good, thanks. I said, you look terrible. What happened? He goes, I can't tell you. You won't believe me if I do. I said, I'll tell you what. You wait here. You calm down, relax. I'll take my shower, then we'll go and talk in the room. All right. Yeah. I problem solve. Like, so he thinks I'm going to be there for him. I know something comes. He's like, ah! But thanks, buddy. See ya. And I go. And just in case, and again, I'm problem solving, whatever was there that I was being to sense or feel or hear, I didn't want to have it like in the movies where they trip. You know what I'm talking about? It's like, here's the person. Is that you, John? You sound different. Yeah, I know. It's a growling creature. I'll keep walking backwards in the dark. That's what I do. The dog is cut in two pieces. The phone's out. I think I'll walk backwards and then take a shower. What? And they always check every time. Oh, no. I'm like, chew your leg off. Get up. Do something. Just don't. No, you know, you're going to die. You deserve to die. You're going to. Oh, my God. It used to bother me every time. It's like, I don't like watching those movies, you know? So here's my plan. If someone's going to get me, there's no way. Here's my plan. I was in the shower. I would step over the rail, which is the door was on the track, and go right. Because right was to the main floor. There were vending machines there and telephones or anything. If I go left, it's a dead end. Oh no, not me. So in my mind, I said, if someone comes in when I'm in the shower, I step over the rail, out. Step over the rail, out, right. I train myself, just like I do for training for football or basketball, with a strategy, a game plan. I can't tell you why. And I remember laughing at myself saying, why am I thinking these things? But since I'm thinking them, I must have a need. There must be something my body or mind is telling me to get ready for. That's all I can tell you about that. So we go back into the room, and Peter says to me, I came in the room, I put my stuff down, and right by me, I'm talking, Chris, a foot or two from my head, I heard someone calling your name. Not once, twice, and nobody's there. And so I said to him, that's weird. Well, here's why. I don't necessarily believe ghosts do these things or can exist in that way. I still think it's probably a practical joke. Maybe he's in the practical joke. who is a stereo. He's my roommate. He has the key to the room. Right? So I'm still trying to problem solve as though we're a great situation, which is how I was brought to this. And he goes, oh, God, I don't want to talk about it anymore. I just so you know, I said, okay, well, listen, maybe you're tired. You know, maybe, I don't know, maybe there's gas release in the room. Maybe you had the bad food. I don't know. So we go over to the dining hall. You know, young kids, if you have young kids at home, especially boys, they eat everything. It's like, where's the box of cereal? Thanks. Got it. Like, I bought this morning. Yeah, it was really good. We eat everything. So back, we ate, and you see what happens later on? See what happens, don't you? There's a warning, see? Anyway, so we go, we eat, we come back. We're working on our stuff. I'm reading a magazine about running, because I love running. And my roommate, Peter, is across the room. I'm sitting here, and he's sitting over this way, about this far away, here. And as I'm reading, he says to me, just look at me, just says, stop it. Stop it, you're pissing me off. I didn't know if maybe I was tapping a pencil, or, you know, making a sound, or sniffing. I didn't know, but whatever I was doing was bothering him, so I decided to be very, you know, conscientious. So I turned the page very slowly in the magazine, very slowly, you know. I'd make sure I wasn't making any noise. He's my roommate. I'm going to be with him at least in May. I don't want any kind of problems where we have a bad relationship, you know. So I'm being very quiet. He says, I told you, cut it out. And he's flailing his arms above his head. So I put the magazine and said, what are you talking about? What am I doing? He goes, you're blocking my light. I said, turn around. He goes, how'd you do that? I said, I didn't do that. I can't block your light. It's over your head. He goes, this place is beep crazy. I'm beep out of here. He told us in television, right? I gotta beep those things out, right? He says, I'm out of here. He says, he's gonna go watch some movie in the lounge. I think it was Sandra Locke, Clint Eastwood and the Monkey. I don't know what those were, but he leaves. I was part happy and part sad. I was part happy because he's going crazy. The part sad because now I'm alone in a room where I heard grass, which I didn't like too much. So I closed the door. I locked it. I made sure the windows were closed. I just, okay, I'm all alone. So I sat there thinking, what is going on? What is going on? What is going on? And I know that each of us have coping mechanisms. Sometimes we eat, sometimes we smoke, sometimes watch television, we go to sleep. And my vice was sometimes having some candy. And so my parents, for Valentine's Day, had sent me a care package. It was Valentine's Day, it was a few days away. And it says, if you want to open, but I opened it anyway. You know, and there's a sweater in there, and there's like a little note from my great-grandmother. My great-grandmother wrote, Dear Catherine Pender, that was Christopher. But I loved it anyway, you know, oh, great-grandma. At the very bottom of the box was hot tamales. Oh, wait, I mean, a cinnamon-flavored candy. Right, that's good, all right? And I love these things, and so I open them up, I'm like, and they stick to your teeth, and the flavor goes fast, you're like, I love them, chewing on this candy, I feel good right now. It's like, oh! So I'm sitting there, and I can't honestly tell you the exact way I noticed it. But as I'm chewing on this candy, I see someone standing. And if I'm sitting here by my desk, the person is standing right here. And I thought, oh my God, how is it possible there's a person in my room? It's like 15 or 14 degrees out. I'm on the second floor. To open the window, they'd have to open it, create this huge draft, there'd be a big noise, have to scale the building, break the window in, that can't be. To get in the room from the door, they'd have to unlock it somehow, break the lock, and walk right past me. That's impossible. No one can be there. That's impossible. I'm going to disbelieve it. I'm not going to believe it's there. I'm going to count to 10. It will be gone. It never happened. When I was a young kid, my sisters and I went to stay with my grandparents. My parents went on a vacation. And that's good for the parents to get away sometimes, away from the kids. And we were with my grandmother. And my sister had a temper tantrum. You ever see one of those from people like, ah, pushing little kids? I'm like, oh, please make me quiet. So my grandmother said to her, just count to 10. So she counts to 10 and she's better. I thought, wow. I said, Grandma, how does that work? Is that magic or something? She goes, no. If you count to 10, you move yourself away from the problem. And you realize, you know what, I'm still okay. Maybe the candy bar is gone. Maybe the dog got out of the house. Maybe you get yelled at, but you're okay. You count to 10, you're okay. It wasn't that bad. Breathe. So I was going to count to 10. And I began to count. Slowly. 1,001. 1,002. And the goal was at 10, nothing is there. I got to 7. It wasn't working. It was not working. The thing, the person was still right there. I said, you know what? I'm wasting my time. Count 3 more. Just look now and see what it is. If it's going to be there, I'll look and see. I didn't, you know. And that changed my life. So I looked like this. I turned. And right there, I saw this thing. It looked like a young man. And his head was tilted. This. His arms were down. His mouth was slightly agape. His eyes were looking straight ahead, but they were like dry. He had like blue and a little bit of gold on top and something in a blue pants, but I don't recognize what kind of pants they were, but he was like this. And his legs were going through the stereo. The stereo that I just put on, the Sammy Hagar thing earlier in the day, through. And my mind couldn't comprehend that, because that's impossible. People can't go through things. People can't get into rooms through walls and windows. That can't happen. This is impossible. And as I told you before, when you run distance like marathons, it's just you. At mile 23, there's no one to carry you across the line, it's you. Did you pace properly? Was your water intake okay? Your carbohydrate loading, was that proper? Did you train properly? It's all you. So I'm clicking through my mind what this could be. I got nothing. I got nothing. And the worst thing you can do in a contest, whether it's football or sport, taking a reasonings exam, the worst thing you do is panic. And I panicked. I couldn't understand it. The box of candy I threw in the air, I screamed like, ow, ah! I screamed. And I turned, I ran to the door, I turned the bolt lock, I ran out, made a right-hand turn. Because why? I had trained myself in the bathroom to go right. But now I'm not facing the same direction, am I? Who am I? I'm that blonde girl. No! I'm like, so I'm running to the dead end. I'm running to the dead end. It's like slow motion. Like, what? Because, this really happens? Are you kidding? I have great respect for people who die in the movies now. That would be me, probably. I shouldn't reproduce, That's me. Oh. The first door I come to, because I'm not going to keep going to the dead end, that's a bad idea. The first door I bang, I'm like, help! Help! Oh, my God, help me! I'm in trouble! Help me, please! I'm banging and banging and banging. I want in. I want to see some person, a living human being. I want to tell someone what's going on. Right at that moment, I think one thing. I am crazy. My mind has snapped. I need treatment. I need evaluation. I need medication. I need help. I need it fast before I hurt myself or somebody else. I'm very fortunate in that the person who lived next door, his name is John Jeff Ungar. He heard me banging on the door. He was down the hallway a little bit. He came running in. Let me in the room. I'll tell you, I didn't say I saw a ghost. I didn't say it's a dead thing. I said, I panicked. I can't believe I panicked. Because to me, panicking is worse than a threat. Because a threat can be looked at, can be neutralized, examined, counteracted. But if you panic, you're helpless against any threat. And I laid there on the floor saying, I panicked. And it took me a number of minutes, which is a long time in a conversation, to finally say, I saw a ghost. And that was hard for me to say, because it's like anything else. When you have something that you think is wrong with you, it's hard to share it. You might be judged, you might be shunned, And as a teenager, you want to really have the respect of your peers, because that's what you're really gearing towards, especially if they live in the same place as you. And he said to me, just tell me what's going on. Please share with me. And he began to listen. And so he said, well, let me go check it out. I said, no, you do not want to go check that. I'm telling you, it's real, it's dead, and it is scary. No, I'm okay. So he got it, like a tripod and a camera and a flash bulb and a fish thermometer and a notepad and pencil and pen and a jacket. I'm like, what the? He walked into that room. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm not going in. Because I thought what would happen for sure is I'd see like a spleen come out, or like an arm or something. Like, oh, it's my fault. It was quiet. After a few minutes, I kind of, one of these things in the hallway with your heart's going. And I looked in, and there he was. He was taking some pictures and things. And I said, well, I don't think there's anything here now. What'd you see? So I described to him, what I'd seen, and this ghost thing, whatever it was, and what I'd heard before with the sound of the voice. And he said, well, I'll write these things down. And that was good for me, because if he writes these things down, there's a record now of what happened. And a psychiatrist or psychologist can say, okay, this is what this is called, and Chris, and here's how we treat this. This could be caused by ingestion of a foreign substance. It could be because genetically, it could be environment affecting you. We're going to treat this so that you don't have these problems anymore. That's what my preparation was for. And he was an English major, so I knew he'd write very well. All right, so, and just so you know, a flash forward, those became what are called the C2D1 journal notes. And those notes were taken over periods of months and months, or it was used at the spine, the backbone, for the book and the movie and the TV show, but they weren't written for public dissemination. They're written just to see if we can track what's happening for me because I was going crazy. You know, so it's odd how things happen that way, you know. Things don't always work the way you plan them. So, Jeff's roommate did not like this, the yelling and the screaming and the carrying on. So Jeff, you know, he made sure I was okay. He made sure I was safe. He agreed to write these things down, then he had to go. So I stood in the hallway by the room, and my roommate came back, and he goes, "What are you doing in the hallway?" It's like, you know, late at night. I said, "No, I'm getting some fresh air." "By the bathroom?" I don't know. He's like, "Whatever, you know, it's whatever." So he walks in, and again, do I tell him what I just saw? Do I not tell him? I'm not sure how to handle it. I don't know how to handle it, so I say nothing. And a lot of times we do that, right? We don't say something. We should reach out for help. We don't, and we make the problem worse sometimes. And maybe it's pride, maybe it's fear. I don't know. I say nothing. He goes in, he gets changed, walks in the bathroom, brushes his teeth, you know, boom, he goes in the bed. And our room was pretty cool in that we decided that to make more space, we'd make a loft. So instead of having two beds on the floor, we had couches down there and desks. We put our mattresses on top of the loft. So if I'm standing, there's a ladder here, here's the loft board, and then the mattresses were here and here, upside of the room. We had a light up there, so we had it upstairs and a downstairs, which is pretty cool, right? So if I'm up early in the morning doing studying with the light on, he won't see it. If he has a girlfriend over, I won't hear that. So it's good we have like upstairs and downstairs. It's a nice thing. The only thing is you have to be careful because if the loft is here, mattress is here, the ceiling is there, you can't wake up real quick and bang your head. I learned that quick, right? So you gotta get up slow. So he goes up, he goes to sleep. So I say to myself, geez, if he can do it, I can do it. So I get my little Walmart boxers on, you know, I walk in, brush my teeth, like, you know, make sure no one's in the bathroom like this, you know, turn real quick. Go back in, climb the ladder, up I go, into bed. So I'm sleeping. And you know how you have a bad day and you want it to end, and you hope that if you sleep, the next day it's a better day? Even if things aren't resolved, it's a better day because it's like the same days you already had. That's how I felt. My hope was I'd wake up the following morning and it would have been just like a strange experience that will never be explained, never has to be explained, it will never occur again. So I'm lying there, and I'm falling asleep, and I hear my roommate, Peter, say, I got my, I'm sleeping. He goes, "There's somebody in the room." I said, "What?" He goes, "There's somebody in the room." So I said to him, "Well, how do you know?" He goes, "I heard downstairs under the loft, like things moving, chairs and things." I'm like, "When'd you hear this?" "Like 10 minutes ago." I'm like, "Oh." He says, "Go check it out." So I said to him, I said, "Why do I have to check it out?" He goes, "It's on your side of the room." I'm like, "Oh, I guess that is a some kind of rationale." I said, "Listen, listen, that's okay, but I'm going to go to the edge of the loft. I'm going to brace myself. I'm going to go down and jump and kick. If someone broke in the room, I'm going to kick him. You know, I'm going to, because you don't break in my room, move things, that's not funny. So I'm ready to go out and fight." But I say to him, I whisper, I'm like, "Listen, need your help, I'll call you." "There's no problem." "Okay, good. You have my back that way." We didn't say "have my back" back then, just this new phrase, but that's how you can phrase it nowadays. So I go to the edge of the loft. I'm like, one of these things, like, you know, like these in the movies. 1, 2, and I jump. But I totally forgot in my panic, the roof's right here, the ceiling. So I jump up, I go bang! I hit my head, and I go bang! Hit my elbow, bump my tongue. I'm like, Peter, I'm down. I didn't do anything. And down goes Fraser, you know, I'm down, you know, I'm like, so I'm calling my friend, my roommate, Peter. I'm like, "Can you believe that? He's not coming down. It's me by myself. What kind of friend is that?" Right? So I do the things when you're a kid you do. You pretend you're sleeping, but you're not. You open your eye a crack, just like a little bit, so they think you're sleeping, but you actually see them. So I look around. It's funny I say these things, but I was really trying just to survive. It wasn't like you see on TV sometimes, like, "Where are you, the ghost of Ebenezer Scrooge?" It wasn't like that, you know. It's like, "Oh my God!" It wasn't like the things you see on TV for the most part. And so I sit up and I see nobody in the room. There's nobody, but the clock is flashing. My chair is moved. And there's a hissing sound, like my tape recorder's on. I'm like, "What the heck?" The door is locked. I check it. There's no way I'm gonna get in. So I said, "Maybe someone's sleepwalking," you know. So I turned off the tape, making the sound, right? And I pushed my chair back, and I guess it's okay. Now, you know, sometimes on television shows, they will rearrange things, take liberties and whatnot. And when you see it on the sci-fi show, you'll see it's me by myself in the room, but it wasn't. In fact, it was Peter who was the one who had said, you know, I hear this. So I climb back up the loft, and remember, my head is hurt, my arm got bashed up, my tongue is bleeding. I'm like, where were you? What do you mean? I called your name like four times. I didn't hear you. I'm like, they heard me in New Jersey. How could you not hear me? You know, I was like so angry. It's, you know, it's like, ah, you guys, never mind. Just go to sleep. Who was it? I said, I don't know. I said, the stuff's moved, but no one's there. Maybe you were sleepwalking. Maybe I just forget to push it in. I don't know. I'm tired. Oh, my head hurts. So I put my head down the pillow like, ow, like that, you know. Click. Tape recorder goes on again. I'm like, I said, do me a favor, please, Peter. Could you please go down and just turn it off? He goes, I'm not doing it. You got to do it. I'm like, why do I got to do it? You did it wrong the first time. I'm like, what? What? Seriously? Okay, you know what we're going to do? Here's the plan. I'm going to spell it out for you. Ready? I'm going to go down there. I'm going to take it out of the wall, plug it, put it in the drawer, and that's it. And I'm going to beat your ass. I'm not going to jump or surprise you. I'm just going to wail on you. I'm so angry, so I climb down the ladder. I walk over. It's on again. I turn off the tape recorder, and I unplug it. Drop the cord around, put it in my drawer. And I say to him, through the board of the loft, all right, buddy, I'm going to beat your ass. Like that. I'm like, yeah. I turn with the ladder, and right here, about a foot from me, where I was just standing, I see this. I'm like, oh, it's right there. I'm like, I'm going to beat you. Brum, 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 brum. Just like the damn movies. So I look for a weapon, self-defense, and the only thing I can see on my dresser or desk is a hairbrush. But it's hard plastic. I'm like, ow. You know, I was like, yeah. So I grab the hairbrush and I go, I throw as hard as I can throw. I'm like, yeah. And my first moment of bravery, you know, epic fail. It goes at this thing. Right through it, goes up the wall. Bing, bing, bing. I'm like, oh shit, I'm out. I go up the ladder, I'm like, whoop, under the covers. And I'm in, I call it like the submarine, where my mouth is only showing. It's like, so I can breathe like 1,000 degrees under the sheets. Your heart's going, can I get a breathe? What happened? Don't worry. What happened? Leave me alone. What happened? Leave me alone. All right. So I'm under there thinking, what's going on? What's going on? What's going on? It scares me. I can't see it. I can't hear it. I can't affect it. I keep seeing it. Am I crazy? It's horrible. I can't relax. So I'm with my own thoughts under the covers like a child. And think about that too. The thing you want to do, if there's danger, is to watch the danger, observe it, to track it. Not hide under the covers. Like you're 5 years old. If it can't see me, if I can't see it, it can't see me. Yeah, oh my gosh, what was I doing? Horror movies, genius. Right? So I'm under there. And then Peter says to me, he says, there's somebody in the room. And my heart about stopped. I said, what do you mean? He goes, there's somebody looking at me at the foot of the loft. Now this is my moment. This is my moment to find out what's happening. If we're seeing the same thing independently or not. I didn't ask him, what does he look like or she looks like? I said, what does it look like? So I want to know without leading him on any way. And he said, looks like a young guy with a broken neck. Bingo. He had heard the voice. I didn't say anything about it. Independent for me. He saw this thing. I didn't say anything about it. Independent for me. Then I knew at that horrible moment, something was happening in that room. I wished it was my mind. And I realized it wasn't that easy. You can't take a pill. You can't get therapy and make that go away. It's there. We have to deal with it. And so very calmly, I said to him, very methodically, I said, kick it, hit it, kick it, do something. It's gone, it's gone. What do you mean it's gone? You lost it? So we both sat up in our lofts with our sheets over our head. It's two grown guys, you know, we're rocking. He's facing me and he says, we're going to die. Please stop that. We're not going to die. It's going to hurt a lot. I'm like, I want you to be quiet right now. I want you to be quiet. They'll find their bodies. I'm like, would you please stop? You're not helping anything. So he says, we have to get help. I said, sure, what are you going to do? No one's going to believe us. He goes, in the movies, they always... I said, those are the movies. He said, let's go to a church. We'll get a priest. I said, all right, well, if you want to get a priest, but you talk. This is your idea. Plus, I went to that church, you know, some people saying, oh, there's the guy right there, you know, so it's all company, because I know where it is. So when the sun came up, that's a weird thing, too. It was dark out, we were like this. When the sun came up, we're like, hey, all right, what's that about? It's like Toy Story. Ah, the claw, you know, it's like, what? For some reason, in our minds, we associate darkness with fear and light with safety. And so even though we're in the same room at that same moment, as the sun came up, we got more relaxed and more relaxed and more relaxed. That's, I always wonder about that years later. Why did that happen? Why does it happen with us? Is it that our mind goes out of control, trying to fill in the blanks of darkness? Or is it because we're trained that way? Or is there something about light and dark that affects our minds that we can't quite understand? So we march up to the church, and we knock on the rectory door. And I said to the figures, listen, you know, if they call the police, you are done for. And he said to me, and this is like, I guess my dad, but, you know, but he said, why? I said, because I run a 14-foot mile, you don't. If the police come, they're going to find you, they're not going to find me, so just make sure you're on this one. So as we knock on the door, he says to me, just so you know, I don't believe in God. I'm like, now? At the church door, after we knocked, you tell me this? He said, yes, you do. Poker face, put it on. You really believe strongly. Come on, man, do this for me. And he had promised to talk. He promised, because remember I told you I bit my tongue? I was talking like this. So far, you know, hello, fellow of mine. I'm having a problem. I was like, oh, boy. Rough night, huh? Yeah, boy. Like, come on. So he couldn't do it. And so when the door opened up, it was a woman. My guess is like a cleaning staff or maintenance staff. And she said, can I help you? I said, yes. We need to see a priest. And she looked at us. And remember, we didn't sleep the whole night. Our hair's like this. We hadn't showered. I'm like, we need to see a priest. So it wasn't good. And I knew it. But we were desperate for help. She said, can I ask what for? I'll pass the message on. Because it was Saturday morning around 6:55 a.m. It was early. And I said, well, we have something wrong with our room. She's like looking like, okay. There's somebody who doesn't belong there in our room. I said, well, did you call the RD? Did you tell somebody? Campus security? I'm like, All right, there's a dead thing in our room. She's like, oh, like a squirrel? She's like, I can tell you, we had a squirrel die in our attic. That thing smelled. I'm like, oh, so if I just, I said, we have a ghost in our room. We're going to die. And she looked like that, like waiting for the next thing. And we're just like crying. Like, she goes, I'll see what that can do. Close the door. I'm like, oh man, we're in so much trouble. They're gonna lock us up. It seemed like an eternity. It was probably like 40 seconds. She comes back and says, the priest isn't here. He's at a wedding in Rochester. I'm not a rocket scientist. Who gets married at 6:55 on Saturday morning? Answer, nobody. Right? Choice A, nobody. So what that meant was they didn't want to see us. They were the one to help us out. But luckily she said, there's a person I heard of. His name is Father Charles Manning. I'll give you his number. I had heard last year him tell a ghost story. I don't know if it's true or not. Maybe he can help you. She gave me this number. And I was so happy to have something. So we walked back to the room. And so it was Peter and myself. And then we went met Jeff next door. He had the notes. We went over all things are happening. Our plan was to call this Father Charlie, have him read the notes, and then we'd answer the questions in regards to it. And Jeff said, as long as you get the notes back to me, you can do that. We made the phone call. Went to the place, it was called an interfaith center. I guess that's where, no matter what you are, whether you're Hindu or Buddhist or Sikh or Wicca or Jewish or Muslim, or whatever you are, you can go there in ecumenical services. It's kind of a cool thing. And Peter says to me, listen, I'll talk this time. I'm good now. I'm like, thank you. The guy opens the door. He's like this. He's like 6'3", like a linebacker. And Peter says, you tell him. I'm like, if not for the priest being there, I'm going to punch you in the face, but it's not probably the same for a priest. I'm going to punch him in the face. Is that okay, sir? So I said what was going on, and he brought us in, offered us coffee. We said no. He read the notes. He read them for over an hour, just page after page after page. He put the notes down, kind of like a final exam you're being graded by your professor. You know? He said, I believe you. I want to help. I thought, oh my gosh, thank you. Thank you so much. He said, I have some questions. Like, hey, any question you want. Thank you so much for taking the time. Thank you so much. I was ready to cry, you know. He said, you guys doing drugs? It's like those lottery tickets where you win, but it's fake. I won! Because your boss, I quit, and it's not real. It's like, oh, my. I was so happy. Then, boom, I said, no, we're not joking. Why do you think? I run it. He goes, no, relax. I'm not accusing you of anything. You're coming here for help. And I can tell by your face. I can tell by what's written here. You guys are in trouble. And I want to help you. But if you are doing drugs, I don't ask the question. I can't help you, can I? I'm like, no. So please understand, it's my job to help the best I can. I'm going to ask you questions because I want to see what the factors are. Can I keep asking questions? I'm like, yeah, yes, I'm sorry. I apologize. You guys have been smoking stuff. I'm like, no, no. So we kept all the nose. I said, okay, here's what I'm going to do. Give me 2 days. I'll be there Wednesday. I'm sorry, I'll be Monday, 8 o'clock, and I'll come and I'll fix your stereo for you. I looked at him like, did you read the notes? Our stereo's not broken. I know, but I'm not going to go to the dorm and say, hey, I'm here for the ghost, right? Your notes, if there's a stereo, I'll fix it. I'll be your repairman. I'm like, that is so cool. An undercover priest. Isn't that cool? I'm here to fix the shutters, priest.
Whoa!
That'd be a great teacher. That's the coolest guy ever. So that was great. We can make it for 2 days. I think we could do that. We walk back to the dorm, Erie Hall. And you know what's really weird? I walk in the room, and it seems a little nicer. It's not quite as cold. The clocks aren't flashing as much. It seems like things are a little better. I thought, now how is that possible? Is it psychosomatic? Am I just more alert now? Is it, do people have abilities to like reach out beyond themselves? I don't know, but what I did know was I felt better about things. It seemed like things were okay just for having talked to the priest. Well, they weren't okay. That evening, I'm lying in bed. And you ever toss and turn at night, like it's too hot or you're too cold, you toss from left to right, and somebody's looking at the clock, what time it is to get up and work in the morning. I remember I fell asleep looking at Peter, and I'm looking at him and to make sure he's still okay, and I fell asleep. And then at some point in the night, I stretched him like, I thought to myself, there's Peter, there's the ceiling, there's the wall, there's the ghost face. And I'm thinking, hold the phone. Something's not quite right. But I'm sleeping, so the brain passes a little slower, you know what I mean? So I'm like, I'm thinking, okay, let's think. Peter, check. Ceiling, check. Wall, check. Ghost face. Oh, it's the ghost face, doesn't belong there. So I'm sleeping somewhere, I'm like, wait a minute. Because when you're sleepy, you can't just like, hey, everybody, I'm awake. It's like, you know, it's 7 o'clock already, I gotta work. So I'm thinking, what? Then all of a sudden I realized, holy cow, there's a ghost in the room. I seen it. I open my eyes, it is right here. No. Right here. Now think about that for a second. Imagine if you're at your house tonight, but I hope it doesn't happen to you, and you're sleeping, right? And you look up, and there's a person looking at you like, how's it going, man? Like, even if it's a birthday joke, it's a friend, it's this kind of thing, you'll never forget that moment. You'll never forget it, right? Because you don't feel safe. How'd they get in my house? Can they get in my house again? So once you're broken into or someone does that to you, you'll check the door lock 4 times, check the windows 4, because you're defenseless. But what do you do when it's already dead? What do you do when it can go through walls, just watch you at night and be quiet? I mean, what do you do? I screamed. That's right, I screamed. Down the loft and the hallway. So if you know anybody who went to Geneseo in the mid-80s and said there's always this guy wearing his boxer shorts at night screaming, that was me. And it's surprising that people know about this experience that I didn't know because I was so involved in my own situation. I didn't know how much it affected people beyond me, and I found out years later. A couple hours later, I came back in. I calmed myself down saying, you know what? I was sleeping, you know, it's maybe I was just dreaming. It was like that waking dream kind of thing. Maybe it really wasn't there, but my face felt numb. My ear felt numb, but so I come back in bed. He was sleeping. And I put my pillow down, and I went like, and the pillow went whoop around my head. I'm like, okay, don't panic, don't panic. If you lay down too quick, the pillow can actually fall under your head. It's nothing, it's just physics, that's all it is. I reached the pillow, back under my head. Zip, I'm like, okay, that's really weird, because this had happened twice, I went very slow that time. Maybe it's caught on something, I'm just gonna pull the pillow back, and that's fucking, you know, it's my pillow. I put the pillow under me, and it gets pulled back, I'm like, what? So now, I turn, I'm on my knees, I'm like, I put my feet around the edge of the loft, I'm like, let go of my pillow! And I'm like, pulling on this pillow. It's like tight. I'm like, wah! That's my pillow. Come on. You know how like you have like a blanket when you're a kid? Or something? That's my pillow. I brought it from home. I was like 7 years old. Don't take my pillow. You know, it's like, ah. So I yell. I said, Peter, if you're my friend, you will look right now. You have to see this. I don't honestly. I'm like, please, if you're my friend, you value your friendship, you look. And he saw. He saw me fighting nothing for my pillow. Fighting nothing, like holding on. And so I remember Lorraine Warren had said in that silly thing she did, she said, I put it back in my head. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to leave this place. That's all I could think of. All my biology homework, my history homework. The one thing I think it solved was what she said in that silly thing she did. And I said it. Thump, I'm like, what the? And what do you do? I didn't ask for it. Many people, you folks probably will look for these things and find wonderful things. I didn't want it, honestly. I wanted to run and watch baseball games and dance. I was a very basic kind of guy, you know? But I wasn't given a choice in this matter. This was going to happen. Horrible, horrible, freaky things. So it got to the point where I couldn't go to class anymore because I couldn't sleep. I couldn't do my work. I couldn't do my papers. I was failing everything. And my coach called me from track and cross country and said, hey, buddy, what's going on? He called me Tiger. He said, hey, Tiger, what's going on? I said, yeah. He goes, you know, you missed two practices. You're on a scholarship here. We need you. You know, one of the reasons you came to the school is because you're going to help us with our athletic program, and we're proud to have you, and you're a great runner, but if you're not here, it doesn't count for you, and we can't have you on. I want to help the team. You're a great runner. I said, sorry, coach, I tried to call you. I should call you. I'm a little bit sick. I'm not feeling well. Give me a couple of days, please. He goes, oh, at least thank you for telling me that. I'll give you a few days. Please, keep me informed what's going on. Are you getting a strep throat? Or, yeah. I said, I'm not sure. I'll go to the doctors. I lied. I got to say. So everything was in jeopardy, and it was just a really, really tough time. The next day, I was skipping class, and also, if you have any teenagers at home, they don't always do their chores, they don't always make their bed, or put the garbage out, or feed the dog, or, right, this happens, and so I was very lucky when I was younger, my mom did laundry for me, but at college, So it ended up being like a pile of, like, 4 foot high of dirty laundry in my closet, and I'd be wearing boxer shorts, typing. I'll get it later. So there I was in my pocket shorts typing my paper. I'll get to it later. And there it comes again. I'm like, no. I can't let you control me. I can't let this happen. You're not there. You're not going to come near me. I'm telling you right now, you don't belong here. Get away. No, I'm thinking in my head, no. On my neck, icicle fingers. Bang, I fall on the ground. I'm like in a fetal position, like, stop. And the thing's over me like this. And I remember thinking to myself, am I going to die? I'm going to die, aren't I? I'm probably going to die. And on my wall at college was a movie poster, 2010. There was 2001 by Stanley Kubrick, and 2010 came up that year. I thought to myself, my gosh, you know, that's 25 years from now. I'm going to be alive then if I'm dead. You know, I don't know if I'm going to make it that far. And I waited for about 20 minutes. The thing kind of slinked away, and I got up. Like, wow, I don't know what to do. The following night, the priest came. And I almost forgot he was going to get there because I was so caught up in my mind. The phone rang, and RD said, here, there's some guy here, picture stereo. I'm, oh, yeah. And I had a picture of, like, a half-naked lady, so I pulled out that, and I was thinking, it's a nice poster, too. I'm like, yeah, I spent money for that. And there's, like, a little wine glass there. She's a bikini. I'm like, okay, hello. You know, down, because the priest is coming. So my dad said, good reputation. It's up to the closet. I lead him downstairs. He looks so cool. He had, like, this trench coat on. He had the collar. He had a briefcase. I'm like, man, that's so cool. Again, like, this is the coolest priest ever. We walk into my room, he says, this is the place. I walk on in, and he says, all right, I want you to just relax, I want you to sit still, and I'm gonna take care of this for you. And so he lights four candles, 1, 2, 3, 4, and he begins to do this ritual. It's the same prayer, one time, then second prayer, same order, third prayer, and I'm just writing things down. And when he's done, it's all quiet. And so I said to him, did you do an exorcising? And he said, exorcism? I'm like, yeah, that's it. He goes, no, are you possessed? I'm like, no. Right, because the note suggested it was somebody outside of you, like a spirit. I'm like, right, because I did a blessing. What the blessing does is the blessing tells that spirit to find rest someplace else. You know, some people call it the cleansing. I thought, oh, that's great. So can I come back in? Can I come here? He goes, only if you invite it back in. I said, that's never going to happen. And the reason I was so worried is because the night before, my roommate had left. He just left. After he left the college, and you know, 1985, that spring, I've never seen him since. I have not seen him since. He left behind most of his books, most of his clothes, and that was it. And it's only because people were doing research years later that I found out that he's still alive, you know. And it takes a while, I'm sorry, but it took 75 days, and I hope you're not bored by this, but what's happening to her, but I want to take a quick segue real quick and have you speak with and listen to Mr. Alan Lewis. He's a gentleman who, 9 years after the haunting, reached out and spoke to my roommate, Peter, and to Father Manning. I thought maybe it'd just be cool to have him speak tonight, because he hadn't done it before, and tell you what he discovered, then hit back into the story and finish up. All right, so if you don't mind, Alan? You want the catbird seat?
No, I'll be fine here.
There's a catbird seat anyway.
Yeah, as I mentioned before, I had known Chris, I knew Jeff, and so I wasn't present for the haunting, but I was one of the first people, you know, outside of the, didn't go to Geneseo, that heard about the whole story. And I was just absolutely stunned and amazed by the whole story. You guys have not heard the whole story yet, so you still have to go, and it's just amazing things. And it really did start to affect my life a lot, just, you know, my belief system, to think, wow, these things are really happening. These are people I trust and can talk to, and some of the evidence shown. I was completely convinced by the story. So I always was curious about the idea of corroborating the story, you know, finding ways to prove this was true. And in fact, part of the story, there is a photograph associated with the story. And I did some research, and I found out there was a place in Ohio called the Ghost Research Society. You can send in, you know, back in those days, it was back in 94, I think it was, you could send in your photographs and they would test them and, you know, let you know if they thought they were genuine or not. By that process, this photo actually wound up on the internet later on. So, like, this story, like, kind of became an urban myth on the internet because of that photo going out. And, the gentleman did come back, Dale Kashmarek was the name, and said, you know, this is why I think this photo was genuine. And you'll have a chance to see that photo if for anyone who's not seen it. But another thing we wanted to do is go back and follow up with the people involved. Now, the person we're calling Peter because he didn't really want to be associated with the story. He didn't have any contact with either Chris or Jeff in future years. And he was hard to find. I was able to find him through the phone book and through some resources, talk to him and kind of explain the situation, researching the story, trying to corroborate. He was not real excited, not real happy, like, oh, great, I've been so happy to talk about the story. Not like that at all. And in fact, we mentioned that later on there was the Sci-Fi channel that did an episode on the whole matter. The individual we're calling Peter was again contacted as part of that. And that time he said, no, I don't want anything to do with it. So between the time when I saw him in 1994 and more recent days, he's refusing to have anything to do with it at all. But in those days, he did agree to meet me. I went over and talked to him. And we had all these notes about everything that had happened in all these stories that as Chris related them and Jeff had written them down. And one by one, I started asking him. Because this was a guy who wanted nothing more to do with the haunting than the story, had been so disturbed by what happened, he fled. And in fact, he showed me his house and said, this is a newer house. You know why? I wasn't going to buy an older house because I wasn't going to take a chance of living somewhere where there could be a ghost. So this was an individual that had never forgot what happened, and his life had been altered by it. So I started, you know, if there's ever a person who was, if this story was not true, this is, you know, would be someone who would definitely not have any reason to go along with it. So one by one, I started asking him about the things that happened. You know, see if he's going to hold back up. What do I remember? He remembered everything. And 9 years later, Chris had been telling, you know, the story to his close friends and things for years. So it never left his consciousness. This individual we call Peter, I don't think, my impression was he'd never told anyone anything, or very little. And you could just tell by his reaction, he was not used to talking it. He remembered every single detail. So, I mean, you talk about the way a haunting can have an effect on your life. It had a really harsh effect in his life, I believe. And he said, he did, in fact, there were three things we talked about that I wanted to know if he'd seen. He did, in fact, see a shape of a boy, of a young man, in the room with the head tilted aside. Yep, he saw that, just like Chris said. Another thing we asked him about, did he hear the voice calling Chris's name? Yep, just the way Chris described it, you heard that. And most compelling of all, he did in fact see Chris on his bed having a tug of war with thin air with his pillow over nothing. So I'm like, wow, that's really amazing. He saw all those things. And then he said, well, that's not all as well. You know, he had not, and again, this is not an individual who went around talking about his story or telling other people. He said, there were other things that happened in that room when no one else was there that I never told him about. He said, one time I was up in the loft. I looked down and I could see where the desk was, and I could see a pair of legs sitting at my desk, going underneath the desk when no one was there. These ghostly white legs I could see. He said, another time I was sitting at my desk and I had several notebooks let out. Notebooks started floating in the air right in front of me. Again, this guy wanted no attention from it. He didn't care if I believed him or not. He just presented that thing matter-of-factly. So I thought that was a very, very powerful corroboration. And Father Charles Manning, we were able to locate as well. Went to see him. He was still a priest. He was in a parish now, and you know, was a local priest of something, you know, to south of Rochester Church. I asked him about the story. He had three very interesting things to say that Chris didn't know. One is that he said when he heard about the story as a priest, he felt he had two obligations. One was to help Chris, who was in torment, someone coming to him for help. But he said there was another individual he wanted to help, and he felt obligation to try to see if he could assist, and that was the spirit. As a priest, the spirit was something that he was concerned with as well. He was hoping his ritual could be of benefit to the spirit. Second thing he told me was this whole idea about the undercover priest, something he didn't tell Chris at the time. It wasn't just that he didn't want to cause commotion. He told me he wasn't sure what the legality was of what he was doing, because he was going on to a state college, into a state college dorm room, and perform a religious ritual without any sanction from the university officials. With the separation of church and state thing, he wasn't sure if it was legal or not, or you know what that was. So going in undercover was actually cover for him. He wouldn't have to try to explain himself or get justification or bring more publicity to it. So that was another reason. Third thing he said was when he did the ritual, he spread holy water all around. And he said, yeah, according to the training he had, if you spray holy water and put it down, you look for reaction. If you see smoke, you know, or steam or any kind of reaction, when you put holy water down, it means you're dealing with a spirit that's malevolent and it's evil, and, you know, you might be in a different circumstance. He said when that didn't occur, it was actually, in his mind, you know, a good sign that that didn't happen. So those are some things we were able to verify. So that sound good?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
See, I told you I was a smart priest. by mistake, I left out one thing Mr. Lewis hit upon real quick. That's the photograph. A lot of times when people are looking for proofs, they turn to things that are either audio or visual in nature, because the way you feel, you can always prove. Well, I know it's that personal because I felt that, but you really can't have any way to justify that. You have to look for things that science can look at and say, okay, this is a reflection, or this I can't explain, or this sounds like it could be the person next door in their car. This I cannot explain, and you build, you know, proofs over time. My friend next door, Jeff, he found out the priest was going to come there, and he was a little concerned, saying, listen, if the priest comes there and exercises the blesses of the room, the ghost is gone. This thing is calling your name. It knows your name. It's following you around. It wants something. Let's see if we can talk with it. Let's see if we can find out what's going on. Because imagine that if we could find out, like, what's it like on the other side? You know, what are the religious truths about these things? Or, you know, is there somebody who want to talk with him that might be alive that could still reach out and be healed by the fact that this person's spirit's here? But I couldn't sleep. I couldn't eat. I thought I was going to die. So I just wanted the priest to come, and I refused to call the priest back and say, please don't come. So he said to me, listen, let's still go in and get some evidence. And so he said we should go in there and we should try to get a picture of the ghost. And so I agreed just for a few minutes. And he told me how if I put my hands like this, and he had me go like this. And if you see the book cover, you'll see what I'm talking about. It's the cover of the book. And I'm like this, and I started to call the ghost. You know, I was like, you know, here, ghost. He said, that's not funny. So, well, I don't know what his name is. We're on Christmas cards, you know. So, and as he's writing things down, the closet door starts to shake. I'm like, what? Oh, come on. No. And as you can tell, I'm very social. I wanted to tell him what was going on. I couldn't talk. I'm like, really? It's not how so many things in the haunting are so frustrating for me, because it's like, it took me out of my game, you know? Then I saw this spirit, this shape start to form. I'm like, oh, no, come on, don't do this to me, please. I was calling you just because he wants to see you. I don't want to see you. This is a mistake. Please don't. And then I see the face, and he's looking at me. I'm like, finally I get out. Like that. Jeff hears that and says, what? And he goes, and I said, take the picture. Take the picture. Take it. Jeff puts the camera up. The flash cube goes off. Boom. And that thing comes right at me. Right at me. It goes right through my body, and it felt like this. This is the best I can give you an analogy, because people ask that sometimes. If you're ever outside on a very hot day, cutting the grass, playing basketball, doing something, and you're hot and sweaty, you get a glass of cold water or iced tea or lemonade, you can feel the cold go down your throat. It felt like my whole body froze and then unfroze. I just fell over on the ground. And the weirdest thing about that was the effect on my body wasn't the bad thing. You always think it's a physical thing that bothers you. It never is. It wasn't seeing the ghost, it was panicking. It wasn't the ghost through my body, it was having it do so against my will. And as I lay on the ground, I thought about a girl in my class who talked about being raped. How it was supposed to be no, she had no control. And she was confused, she was angry, she was sad, felt damaged. I laid on the ground thinking, oh my God, it literally felt like that. Not as bad, obviously, but I thought, oh my gosh, I understand now. When you have no control over yourself, it's wrong, it's mean, it's demeaning. I said to Jeff, I'm out, I'm done. I'm not coming back in this room, it's over for me. And this is right before the priest came. And he said, but where is it? So I saw the ghost, and he'd gone past me up to where my bed was. And so if the pillow was here, he was like this. So I pointed, I said, it's right there. He goes, where? I said, right there. The dead thing is the ghost. I don't see it. I said, look, the dead thing. See the dead thing? Look at that's the ghost. Take the picture. He goes, I don't see it. You can't see the dead thing? You gotta be kidding me. It's a dead thing looking at you. You can't see it? It's right there. Come on, the dead thing. He goes, I don't see it, Chris. I'm like, He goes, here, take the camera. You take the picture. I said, fine, I'm taking one picture. I'm out of here. I got the camera. I lined it up. Took the picture. And I gave him the camera. I zipped out the wrong way, of course. I'm like, dead end. I'm like, oh. And I sat by the corner. I went down like this. I'm like, oh my gosh. I can't believe this is happening. I'm that dumb blonde in the movie. And I said, I probably should produce, you know, because I'm like, I make dumb kids. Oh, that's so sad. He went off to make the copies, you know. So, and later on we would find that's just a, I don't know if you can see or not, but and I can show you later on up close. This was the, we got a skeleton, we got the pelvis. Oh, it moved. Let me bring it back if you're younger.
Put this.
Yeah, I brought the picture. Okay. I brought the picture. It's a weird thing. And he was very happy because it was a proof. I was horrified because, you know, it meant to me. It meant there really was a dead thing following me around, whispering in my ear, watching me sleep. So I was horrified by the proof. So the priest came. He blessed the room, and I was so happy. And for two days, nothing happened. Nothing. I go to school, the class, I could run, the room was warm, no chairs moving, no sights, like, but in my mind I'm thinking, how does that work? Is it the holy water? Is it the intent? Is it some kind of divine plan? Is it a respect that the dead have for people who devote themselves to spirituality? How does that work? How would a person come in there, how would that work? I don't know. A few days later, I went for a run out by Avon, that area, 20. I used to run 10 to 20 miles. And I came back in, and I went into the bathroom, put my towel on the rack, turned the water on, I was taking my shower. And this is weird, because remember I had that scary feeling about something might happen? Remember that? I found myself down in that same spot, but now I think I'm safe. Before I panicked, nothing happened, now I think I'm safe. I'm washing my hair, washing my face, I look up, and I see a human form, a shadow, go across from left to right in the bathroom stall in the shower. I'm like, what? So I do one of these things. I rub my eyes to make sure I wasn't seeing things. Here's why. The light is on the ceiling. like most bathrooms. A shadow would be cast off your feet on the ground. A ceiling light doesn't make a shadow above, right? I could understand that, but so, well, you know, I've been through a lot. Maybe I'm a little traumatized. Maybe I'm not just seeing things past tense. I'll just wash my hair out and get out. As I'm rinsing my hair, I see go back the other way. I'm like, what? I can see it clear as day, in human form. A head is tilted a bit, so I open the shower, I get in the middle of the bathroom. I'm like, hello? Hello? Anyone? And there's nobody. I'm like, holy cow. I'm gonna go back in the shower, I'm gonna turn the water off, and get the heck out, because something strange is going on again. I thought I was safe. I thought the priest had taken care of it. This is freaky. Although on the good side, it wasn't in my room, right? I guess the bathroom had been in the room, so it's a slight victory. So I go in the bathroom, I turn the water off, the shower rather, and as I turn the water off, it feels like someone stabs me in the back. Just boom. And I get pushed against the wall, bang, like this. Like, ah! Literally my fist against the tiles, like bang, ah! I promised myself I would fight. I promised myself if I ever get attacked in that way, I would fight. And I did. I spun around, I put my foot out, and I punched as hard as I could punch. It caught the shower curtain, it was plastic, it tore the shower curtain off the rings, it fell to the ground. Like, I ripped it off the thing. I ran in the bathroom, I'm like, show yourself, you coward! What are you, God, the devil? Show yourself! I was screaming at it. At that moment, I looked to my right, I saw the bathroom mirrors. And I saw in the mirror my back was cut up. I felt the stab, but I thought maybe it was like a, I don't know, a psychic thing, you know? But I had these three marks from up here down to here. Scratch. I felt dizzy. I was bleeding. I felt nauseous. I fell on my hands and knees. And I'm on the tile floor at this. And I just collapsed totally. So my face is on the tile, my stomach, my legs, I'm lying there. And I'm trying to think, what do I do? My world's upside down. I'm being attacked by invisible things. I don't understand. I'm getting less healthy. I'm losing weight. I'm failing college. My life is falling apart. What do I do? And I went to square one. There was a little drop of water on my wrist from the shower. I just looked at the drop of water. And in that water drop, I could see the inverted floor. Usually the image is inverted in a drop of water. That made sense. Okay, so light was working properly. When the drop of water went into the tile grout, it darkened the tile. I'm like, that makes sense. When grout gets wet, it gets darker. That makes sense. It fell from my arm, gravity. That makes sense. Okay, gravity works. Light works. You know, dry wet works. All these scientific principles, I'm beginning to put my mind back together again and say, okay, I'm not insane. And I said to myself, I can't do this. Get the wrong guy, God. Get the wrong guy. I can't do this. I'm done. I just want to find a rock and go to sleep and never wake up. At that moment, the door opened up. Jeff Cad came in, he picked me up, put a towel around me, and pulled me out. And that was a horrific thing, and that really amped up the haunting, because what it turned out to be was, yep, the priest had come, he blessed the room, and I was safe in my room. But I wasn't safe anywhere else. And when the ghost realized it couldn't come in my room, or at least that was a perception, it found me outside the room. In fact, it began to bother people that I knew. And began to grab on girls' legs and people's arms and call my name. People say, I heard the thing calling my name and your name in my room. And at that point in time, I said, well, we need to see somebody. And Jeff and I went to see a parapsychologist. And Jeff warned me. He said, listen, parapsychologists don't always solve cases. They study cases. He's not going to be able to, you know, snap his fingers and make a ghost go away. He'll give you suggestions. And so we go. We see the parapsychologist. And he was amazed because he traveled around the entire world, all over, looking for these cases to investigate. His name was Dr. Lawrence Kaplan. And he said, it's so ironic that I go around the world looking for these things, and it happens on my back doorstep. Right here where I work, it happens. He was astounded by that. And so he said, please record. Get a tape recorder. There were no flip cams back then. And talk to it. Find it in the room and talk, ask questions, and find out what it wants and who it is. And Jeff thought, that's great. We'll have a video proof with the photograph, audio proof with the cassette. I didn't want to do that because every proof I got made me feel worse. It was, imagine if you're walking on a dark road by a lake and you see a little girl drowning and she can't swim. You're the only person that can see her. And she says, help me, help me. But you can't swim either. What do? You leave her to drown because you protect yourself and walk away from it? Or do you jump in and maybe die too with her? What do? I don't know. I mostly wanted to just run. And so Jeff and I decided we would record, just like on the TV show in the movie, the ghost. And the ghost had been in room B2, where girls are saying their hair's being pulled, they're being pushed out in bed, their legs are being touched, they hear things calling their names. So we went there because the ghost was there. And I'll let Jeff in the Q&A section talk about the protocols that we had. But boy, was that a scary thing for us. And I went back to the parapsychologist by myself. And I said to him, please let me understand what is going on. I don't understand this stuff with ghosts and energy. Please help my mind understand. He says, okay, we'll do a little thing. I want you to tell me this. How can you know a boat is in the water if you don't see it? I said, what? He goes, what is a proof a boat is in the water if you can't see it? So I thought. I grew up by West Point and Bear Mountain and the Hudson River's right there. I remembered, if a boat goes past, it creates a wake, a V in the water, behind it. So you might not see the boat at all, but there's proof of the boat because what? The wake is behind it, right? So you can prove the boat was there without seeing it. He goes, exactly right. Exactly right. And here's something else. That same boat, he said, will displace, will lift the water ahead of it. And if you're perceptive enough, you will see the boat before it gets there. And that's pre-ignition. I'm like, whoa. It made sense. I mean, I don't know if I accepted it as a rule, but I finally understood what could possibly be with this paranormal stuff. And so he said to me, I want to do some tests with you. I'm like, oh, no test. It's just one. I'm like, oh. Then I was a polite kid, so he took these cards out. But they weren't like, you know, a queen or king or jack or hearts. They were like these, there's a circle, there was like wavy lines, there's a square, all these shapes. He says, I'm going to put these down on the table. I'm like, I can't do this. He goes, just, I'm going to pick a card up on top. I'm going to look at the card, put it to my forehead, and concentrate. You're going to tell me what the card is. I'm like, I can't, this is embarrassing. I'm going to fail. I can't do this. I have a hard time not eating. Why are you going to embarrass me for? He goes, let's just, look, you can't win or lose. You can't pass or fail. Every person's experience is different. Just do this for me, please. I appreciate it. I'm like, fine. Circle. Running water, all these things. So we get through. He goes, he's all quiet. And he goes, that's interesting. I said, what? He goes, you get everyone wrong. I'm like, I told you. Why'd you do that to me for? I don't have enough time. I'm a failure. He goes, no, you understand. There's like 30 cards. No one gets everyone wrong. They have to get everyone almost impossible. I said, so I'm just that bad. He goes, no, wait. I want to show you something. He brought me over, and he took the pencil. He goes, bump, 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 bump. For the first 9, that's as far as he got, I got the next card every time. I get the card next. Next. So I got this one 9 times. He goes, that's called positive once a progression. I'm like, I don't know what it's called, but I'm out of here. So I felt like I never went back to him. I should have. I feel bad about that, but I was always scared. I told the priest too, you're the coolest priest in the world. I go to your church. I never did. So there was some things to regret going through, but I'm very thankful for the help they gave. And so, but it got so bad toward the end where my friends are being attacked and things are happening terrible. I decided to just face it. And I did what I shouldn't have done. I was told not to do. I decided, since my friends are getting hurt and they're getting suicidal, I'd have to face the ghost. And so I tried to recall what the priest had done. I'd written down a piece of paper. I got some candles, put them in the room with the candles. I went in. I took a shower, kind of like a baptism in a way, just cleaned myself of things. I just walked in like my birthday suit. They kept it on TV, obviously. But it's like, that's how you're made, you know? And I said to one of my friends, his name is Craig, look, I'm going in. I hope I come out. If I don't come out, just please tell people that I was a good guy. I meant well. So I walked in, and I kneeled down, and I said, okay, this is it. If you want my help, now's the time. I'm going to ask to break the priest's blessing. I want you to come in here and talk to me because this can't happen anymore. And I can tell you that I learned from sports that your hips control your movement, your direction. If you play football, you talk, you know your hips control your movement. And so as I was like this, my hips were this way. I got that bolt. I got lost my nerve. And it was a few moments. And you know what? You ever go on a roller coaster? You're like, that looks like it's fun. Yeah. And you're going, click, click, click. Oh, crap. Oh, no. You know, can I just get up here? Can I just get my pillow, sir? Can I just get up? No, you can't. So I thought it would be a great idea, you know. But as I'm sitting, I'm like, oh, what am I doing? This is crazy. But I see the shadow go like this. The shadow goes, like, right next to me. I like that sound effect because that's what it felt like. It's like, and I closed my eyes. I was praying. I'm like, 1, 2, and I counted. I looked up, and there it was. There it was, the thing. It was just standing right here. And I was this close to it. The reason I didn't panic, I think, is because it didn't smell bad. I always wondered, like, you know, if it's a corpse, will it smell like decay? Will it smell like, you know, a rotting, festering sore? Thank God for me in my moment, it smelled like an icebox, like cold, just fresh cold. And I think that kept me next to it so I wouldn't run and scream or throw things again. And it was hard. I remember I was crying, looking so close, and it said, "I'm sorry. Wrong. So wrong." And he put his hand out, but there's no way on God's earth I'm touching that hand. I'll turn my arm off. You're not touching. I was like, sorry, I couldn't get that far. I couldn't do that. I wasn't strong enough, a good enough person. I just couldn't do that. I just kind of pulled back a little bit. And he said, I made a mistake. I didn't know what that meant. I didn't know if maybe he had killed himself, if he had done something terribly wrong. But I understood one thing. Whatever was tormenting him was real. And I understood that he wouldn't find rest until he accepted something. I don't know why he wanted me to talk to him. I didn't want any part to do with it, but you know what? Sometimes it happens. Sometimes you find the stray cat. Sometimes the person with cancer comes to you first. Sometimes a friend who needs money comes to you. And it seemed to me a good person helps people in need. Whatever this thing was that had tormented me and attacked me, it needed help. And as a good person, I just couldn't say no. And so I just said to him, look, you can't stay here. You can't. You're hurting people. People are going to die. You have to accept there's something beyond this, that someone loves you, that somebody's there for you. Please, you have to go. You can't stay here. And it was weird because this thing I had run from, I ran from it 15, 20, I mean, this happened, I gave you a short version, it happened over 75 days. I saw this thing at least 60 times. My dad came up to see if he could help me out. I mean, we had people, newspapers come, it was crazy. And there I was, I guess it's to my credit, right? I guess it's to my credit that I was able to stand there and it's hard for me to talk about and talk to it. And so I did my thing. I said, you have to go, and I just counted to 10. And I opened my eyes and gone. My hope was it was gone. But I didn't trust that because why? Every time I thought it was gone, it came back even worse, right? So even though I thought maybe I helped it find some understanding, I wasn't quite sure it was over and I kept my guard up for days. Then it was around April 20th, 21st, 22nd, where my roommate, when I was sitting there, actually Jeff had moved in because my roommate had left and he kept me safe to stay by me. And I saw one last time the thing in the room and it just looked at me and then it just kind of listened away. And in my mind, that was it saying thank you or goodbye. And that's pretty much what happened to me at that place. And it's an amazing thing. I give you folks credit who look for these things. I do. You're brave people. Well, you're either brave or you're confused, right? But let's face it. But I give you credit because you're looking for something that you don't quite understand. And that's like love. You know, we are raised by our parents or by our grandparents or by our friends or by society. We're raised. And we develop our personality and we have trust situations. When you fall in love with somebody, that's dangerous. Because you trust that person next to you in bed. You trust them with your life, with your finances, you know, with intimacy, with your secrets. And it works sometimes, sometimes not. And love is a tough thing. And just like ghosts, how do you prove hauntings? How do you prove love? Does a ring prove love? I don't know. I don't think so. Does saying it prove love? I don't think so. I think that you prove love. You know love is there when you feel loved. If you feel loved by somebody, probably to some degree you are. That's a good thing. And with hauntings, the same thing. I think that's the way it works. I think if you feel you're haunted, you probably are. But you shouldn't have to prove love to somebody. Look, I love her. I bought her these things. That's not their business. But you and that person. And you shouldn't have to prove to somebody, look, I got this evidence. Look, you see this? Do you see this? I'm telling you. Well, I was here. I got this evidence instead. It doesn't have to be that way. You know, every day is unique. Every moment is unique. Every person you meet is unique. And I think that it's possible to have different answers. But there's one thing I do know. These experiences are real. You can talk with someone. And I do that now at the conventions and the power cons and things. And their eyes will tell you what happened to them. And you get the goosebumps on your arm. I call them chills of confirmation. You know, again, I don't study these things. I don't watch any scary movies. I'm just somebody who found myself, for better or for worse, in a crazy moment. All what people sometimes pray for. A lot of people I know, gosh, I wish, Chris, I could be there and I could be in that room and that ghost was talking to me and I could, oh my gosh. And I respect that. But I have to say this, it's like going to war. After 9/11, a lot of my friends joined the military. And they were very brave. And they wanted to fight for their country and their values and our freedoms. They're good people. But when they came back, they said, talking about it, looking for it, is not the same as being there. And when the bullets are flying overhead, and your friends are being blown up, and you don't know if it's your mom or your baby again, or even a clean bed sheet, you know? And so, for me, it's an interesting dichotomy, because now I get to meet people all over the country. It's a wonderful thing. And I can say to you, look, explore, live your life. But I have to caution you, and here's the dichotomy, just be careful, please. Just be careful. Just like with love, just like with careers, you don't know for sure what will happen. And if these are souls, if these are people who came before us or are hanging on, please take it seriously. Please don't go in there, knock on the wall, curse and leave. All right? Unless it's your grandmother or your daughter or your friend who's sick. Go in there. Get the evidence. Try to understand. Be kind. You know, use open mind. And one last thing, because I've talked for a long time, and I apologize for the length of this, but it's a nice time for me to actually be able to tell you in person rather than through some kind of media format, you know. Just remember, that could be one of you someday. Right? That could be one of you someday. And please, respect it. Respect goes a long way. So try to do your very best to be a good person, to be a decent person. So, you know, when I was a kid, I thought we'll go to heaven. Now I'm not so sure. But I'd like us to. I'd like to be the place where we can find rest, like that spirit hopefully found rest. We can put our head down one last time and say, I did good. But in the meantime, please, please be good to your friends. Be good to your parents. Be good to your kids. Be good to your neighbors because, you know, when push comes to shove and you close your eyes one last time, one last breath, you want that to have happened. You know, so I thank you from the bottom of my heart for giving me your time. I really appreciate it. And so I hope I have a good experience.